started on the exegesis of Matthew 24, 21 through 28. A couple of things. Because my computer does not allow me to stop and start, I'm going to go ahead, and so I don't have to hold you up the way we've been doing it. You're going to see some transitions from one thought to the next, from one verse to the next verse. So don't let it, I'm not erasing anything or taking anything out. It's just as I'm studying through, you're going to just see from one transition to the next, you'll just see maybe a little swirl, or it'll float in to the next part of what we're studying. So until I'm able to get a webcam that will be able to do that, and I guess they are out there, I'm investigating it now. Second thing is, I did want to mention something about the prophetic. My life is kind of prophetic. You and Him Ministries was a name that was given to me by a prophet by the name of Michael Ratliff back in 1990. It was during a prophetic conference, and the way that he expressed it was, the Lord is telling you, you'll be under new management. Do you understand what I mean, Pamela? You in him, under new management. And so as I began to live my life, when the Lord took me out of the Virginia, D.C. area, and we had to, now we have the ability to have email accounts, I would go ahead and put my email up as youinhimministries@gmail.com. And so that held. And then when I saw the Hubble photograph, you'll see the front of each one of my videos. You will see that star that is so far out where it looks like Jesus is hanging on the cross. He's not hanging on the cross, and we know He's not there anymore. But you see the cross, and it always reminded me the Lamb that was slain from the foundation of the world. And I kind of think that's what it is. That's why you will see that there. So You and Him Ministries was prophesied. It's not something I made up out of my own mind. It is something that God gave me as a calling. The second word that I got from the prophet was not like Catherine Kuhlman, but in a more productive way. Now, what is it that I do? I produce teaching by video. And that happened by a serendipitous event. Something terrible happened to me, and the third day in, after I was weeping and grieving over what had happened, the Lord asked me to go to a TV station in the area where we live and asked me if I would do some orientation and learn how to work in a television studio. And while I was there, I learned how to edit videos. It was on a thing called Final Cut. I don't use Final Cut for these. I will be eventually. I'm going to be reacquainting myself with it. It might be a better system, but for now, I use AVS for You, which is a better format for me and a better platform because I can do things a little quicker. And believe me, this is not quick. This takes time. Anybody that thinks it doesn't take time to put the scriptures down and do the editing, what I did in my former life to make a living, I worked for a lot of law firms, and I also, in order to make extra money, I edited dissertations and theses for college and university students by using Turabian, MLA, Gray's Anatomy, and APA format, which helps me in my doctoral program now. So sometimes you'll get a word that'll say everything that that the Lord has put you through will have been training for what it is that you're doing now. So that is training for what I'm doing now. And then the third thing that I heard Him ask me to do, and this was in my own heart, was to get my doctoral degree. And that was something that didn't make any sense to me. I have a degree in music, vocal music, and speech. And so I laughed, and I said, that's not possible. I don't have Bible school. They're not going to let me in. However, they asked me a couple of questions, and serendipitously, they let me in at Northwest University and I obtained my master's of ministry degree, but there wasn't enough hours to do a doctorate, and I couldn't do it online. I am married, and for me to leave my husband and go out of state didn't make any sense. So I applied and looked at a couple of other seminaries and other universities, and nothing worked out but Liberty University. And so that is the door the Lord had me go through. So there I earned my Master's of Divinity. And then I thought I was going to have another letter of recommendation sent to the school for the doctoral program. However, they invited me in to the education training program for doctorate of Christian education leadership, which so that's what I'm doing now. It is leadership, Christian leadership in education. And the format that the Lord has me using right now is to not do pulpit speaking. I will let you know right now, I do not see, and I will be addressing this until the Lord shows me that I'm not right, that yes, women can minister. And I have just gone through a ministry tape that another doctoral student has done, and they can make the case for a woman ministering, but they cannot make a case for a woman being ordained as a pastor or an overseer of a church, because the Greek word that they keep trying to push through their teaching was he, translated into anyone. It doesn't work in the book of 2 Timothy when Paul is writing the letter about a bishop and an overseer. It does not work. It does not translate. And I apologize to all the women out there if I make you angry or you want to get upset about it. There's a very good book out there by Wayne Grudem that makes a very good case about women ministry, and it's actually, I will, in the next scene, give you the name of that book, which is why I'm going to do pauses and transitions from now on. So I just think it's going to be a lot, it's going to be a lot better format until I can get a video that will stop and start. So I may have a different expression on my face. My face may be tilted a different way. But anyway, I love what I'm doing. I really believe this is my calling for right now. And I can't wait for Christmas, because this year I'm going to be able to actually have a real Christmas party in a real office type of venue, God willing. And so I'm excited about it. I'm going to be sending out individual invitations to my friends. So if anybody's watching this video, if you don't get an invitation, please email me at pam@youandhimministries.com. And say, hey, where's my invitation? And I'll let you know when it's coming. And we're if it were Halloween, I guess we could wear Halloween masks. Anyway, I will be back on. We'll start in with the teaching on the next slide. To the name of the book that I wanted to let you know about is called Evangelical Feminism? A New Path to Liberalism by Wayne Grudem. And you can get that at Amazon, either on Kindle, or you can also get that in hard book cover. Okay, we're going to go ahead and pray ourselves through so that we can look at verse 21 of Matthew 24. Father, I just hold this teaching up to you, Father God, in Jesus' name. Lord, that we will understand exactly what is going on when you spoke of the great tribulation in Matthew 24:21, and as far as we can get today. But Lord, that we go slowly, that we let you illuminate what is going on. And Lord, that we look forward to your coming, that you are our blessed hope. But Lord, that if we do have to go through persecution, that we will know how to conduct ourselves in belief and faith. And we give you all the glory and the honor in Jesus' name. So we are looking at the Blue Bible Study and by the interpretation of Matthew 24, 25 by Thomas Ice. He's calling this part 15, but we're looking at Matthew 24, 21, and he's calling it the tribulation. When we look at the Geneva translation of the King James Version and also the Passion Translation, they'll be a little bit different. However, it's still talking about the same verse 21. And Matthew 24, 21 in the King James Version says, "For then shall be great tribulation, such as was not since the beginning of the world to this time, no, not ever shall be." I would like to go back into verse 20 because that's where we left off in our last study. And verse 20 said, "But pray that your flight be not in the winter, neither on the Sabbath day. And it was not lawful to take a journey on the Sabbath day." And that was in Josephus book 13. And so in 21, then again, "For then shall be great tribulation, such as was not from the beginning of the world to this time, nor shall be." And going on with Thomas Ice, he is talking about, says, "The Lord's prophetic discourse continues dealing with mid-tribulational events." Now, he is a pre-trib teacher. However, during pre-trib, it looks like Israel's going to get their temple. It looks like the man that is running things and helping everything come back to order throughout the world is giving them everything that they want. But not only be tribulation is noted in the first half of Matthew. Remember, we read in Matthew 24:9, "Then shall they deliver you up to be afflicted, and shall kill all you nations for my name's sake." That was then, as well as coming to pass now. In fact, it will be the greatest time of tribulation since the beginning of creation, as registered in Mark 13:19, King James Version. "For in those days shall be affliction, such as was not from the beginning of the creation which God created unto this time, neither shall be." So, speaking of the tribulation, this verse 21 starts with a reference back to the preceding section, and he's mentions Ed Glasscock, who explains Matthew 24:21 offers an explanation for the illustrations of urgency just presented and uses the temporal adverb tote, or then, to connect the previous statements with the prediction of the worst tribulation ever. And the footnote that he is giving here is, you can find Ed Glasscock. He's written a book called Matthew. It is the Moody Gospel Commentary. The publishing company is Chicago, Moody Press, 1997, pages 470 through 471. And so they had that command to flee, as we saw in Matthew 24:15. So now we're going to go into, and so if I do stop and do a transition, which will be another slide, that way I'm not keeping everybody's time while I go through this. This is not me. This is great historians and teachers that I am referring to. I'm not a know-all and be-all. However, I will bring to you what I believe are the best commentaries of the texts who have done their homework and can teach us.
Hi, I just want to interject something here. I made this video or started the teaching yesterday, and this is the next day. As I'm going through this, When I woke up this morning and took a nap this afternoon, the Lord really alerted me. Tell them who's speaking. This is before Christ was crucified. He is speaking to his disciples, but we must remember, no matter how many great scholars I bring in and introduce you to on commentaries and how exegetical works, we must always remember that it is our Lord Jesus Christ that is speaking in the text. So let's not get adrift as we go ahead and look through what it means. But what it is Jesus's voice, and the history is 2,000 years ago, and the geographical setting is in Israel, and this is historical. So I'm going to go ahead and sign off and continue letting you watch what we have just watched through Dr. Glasscock. And obviously, he's quite learned and has quite the pedigree. You can actually go into, I have put his website on there. You can actually go in there and see all of the work he's done. In other words, this tells the Jewish remnant in Jerusalem and Judea why they need to immediately head for the hills when they learn of the abomination of desolation event in Matthew 24:15, which read, "When ye therefore shall see the abomination of desolation spoken of by Daniel the prophet stand in the holy place, whoso readeth, let him understand." Now, it's talking about Israel. I wish the Lord had told us something about the United States, which is a perplexing thing for many theologians when they read through Revelation, that we don't seem to be there. With the events that are going on today, could it be that this next election doesn't go well for the Christians? I have been thinking about it very seriously, and the rapture is not going to get us out of something until the events come to pass that God wants the church to go through. That doesn't mean he's beating up the bride. It just means, I mean, we have people in Europe and the other countries that are being persecuted. They're Christians. We've just now started to see in Seattle and Portland, Olympia, Washington, New York, and some other cities where the church, oh, California. I had mentioned John MacArthur, and I'm mentioning his name now. He is being persecuted big time. I guess there were like people coming in that he wasn't even asking to come in, and I think he has a congregation of about 7,000 people. They have ended his lease, I know at least for the parking lot, which means that they can't meet there. I guess, and then we have Rodney Howard Brown. Rodney Howard Brown and the people that surround him on the September the 13th through the 20th are going to do a thing called the stand. Actually, what I will do is I will pause this video right now and I will put up the information for that, and then we will go into another transition. Over, according to what my information is, it will be over on Rich Road, and you can contact Debbie richministries.org/the stand. But it will be on Rich Road. And then the next event that's coming.
New Hope Ministries is proud to present Worship Washington on Saturday, September 19th at 2 p.m. This will be on the Capitol campus in front of the fountain. Join us for an afternoon of worship. We are believing God for a move of His Holy Spirit to release and restore and revive the love of God in the great state of Washington.
You can reach New Hope Ministry Center.org for more information. And also bring your chairs.
Victory, so no matter how dark it gets. I heard this wonderful prophetic word that the shadows that we see, all of the darkness that we see around us, are the shadows of the Most High God.
Oh, praise to your name. The name.
We look forward to seeing you there and joining us 2 o'clock Saturday, September 19th. May God bless.
So as you can see, we have a lot of events going on over in the state of Washington. And from what I understand, Rodney Howard Brown, there are other cities that are going to be participating. And I'm not going to put this up, but Franklin Graham is going to have an event for National Day of Prayer. I believe it's going to be in Washington for September the 26th. So I am going to end this video teaching tonight, and I'm going to go in so I can get it up. And so I can go into a full exegesis of Matthew 24:21. We have just started the tip of the iceberg as to what the tribulation is going to be, but we have a lot more to go into. But for time's sake, and also so that you don't have to spend the next 5 hours trying to look through this, I will give you some relief. We'll go ahead and end in prayer. Father, we thank you for the information that you have given us today. And Lord, we just give you all the glory, Lord, that we've got people that are starting to participate and are going to let our government know that you are the government for your people and that they are not to interfere with our worship of you. We will worship. And also, I did want to point out, and we thank you, Lord, there has been an event on Monday, which would have been, what was Monday? So today is the 9th, so it would have been the 7th. On the 7th of September, you can look on YouTube or look for the worship that was going on there. It was for like an hour and 16 minutes, and it was glorious. So everybody's starting to participate and tell the government, no, we will worship the Lord. You cannot stop us. It's not going to happen. And actually, there was, when I looked out there, they said it was going to be worship, protest in worship, not protest where we're going to rip everything down. Enough is enough. And vote your conscience. But anyone who believes that it's okay to rip a baby up in the 9th month in this abortion law, I might want to ask you to please check your conscience and know what's going on and don't say, I don't want to get involved. Please vote. This is important. Vote, because the next 4 years that we get will be dependent upon what we vote for. And who does not want to see babies murdered? Because that's exactly what that is. Enough said. I don't want to rile anybody up. We're not murderers, but the law wants to kill. And it's even in Scripture. The law kills grace and mercy gives life. And I will put a scripture down as I review this video after I get through with it. Anyway, if there's anyone that has not accepted the Lord Jesus Christ as their Savior, I've been instructed, don't ask Jesus into your heart. However, I don't know any other way other than I can put it this way. If you believe that Jesus was born and died on a tree, was crucified, and that that blood that he shed forgives you of your sins, and you want to repent and receive that gift of life and by repentance and accepting Jesus Christ as your Savior, then I invite you into the family of God, and that you will go from death unto life, and you will be born by the Spirit. Unless you're born by the Spirit, there is no other way to the Father but through Jesus Christ. He even said that. And he said that he brought himself back to life in three different scriptures. And I will review that and try to get this up. If I don't get it up on this video, I will remind myself to do it. He said that the Father would raise him from the dead. He said the Holy Spirit would raise him from the dead. And he said that he would raise his own self from the dead, which is the Trinity. And we are not going to argue about the word Trinity is not in the Bible. The word rapture is a different, it's harpazo or some such thing. So we don't want to argue about this. But if you want to be born again and you want to have God come into your life, then I would say do it. Do it. Have him take your heart and renew you by the Spirit of God in Jesus' name. If you do want to be born again and you want to pray the prayer, no matter what legalistic way somebody's saying not to do it, by all means ask for a Bible. A New Testament will be sent to you free of charge. Just email me Pamela Gunderson at or just Pam at youandhimministries.com or Pam at youandhim.info. Or send a letter requesting it at my mailing address, which is 1018 East Wishkah Street, Suite 213 in Aberdeen, Washington, 98520. And we will send you a New Testament right off to you. Anyway, God bless you, and you have a wonderful evening. I will have the next video up forthwith as soon as I get through going through this one, getting information across that you do need to see. Anyway, God bless you.
The sensible, we now by faith approach to thee, shall all with open face behold in Christ the glorious deity, shall see and but the God of thy sinless son, I cannot see.